巴里奥。
Shabbat Shalom, everyone. Good morning, good morning. Let's everybody take our seats. We'll go ahead and get started today. Today's parsha, it's Toldot, Generations. And the Torah portion of it begins in Bereshit, which is Genesis chapter 25 through 28. The Torah portion opens by naming Abraham six sons by his new wife, Keturah. It also names their children and calls them the sons of Keturah. Now, Abraham gave all he had to Yitzhak, Isaac, but to the sons of the concubines he gave gifts, and he sent them away from Isaac. Abraham lived 175 years and died, and Isaac and Ishmael bury him in Machpelah. The Torah speaks of Isaac praying to God for Rebekah to get pregnant, and she conceived, and two were inside her, and they were struggling, and the Lord let her know that two nations were in her womb, and one would be stronger than the other, and the elder would serve the younger. At birth, the first came out red and hairy, and was called Esau. The next came out and grabbed the heel of Esau, and he was called Yaakov, Jacob. Esau became a hunter and a man of the field, and Jacob was a plain man dwelling in tents. We see Isaac loved Esau, and Rebekah loved Jacob. We saw Esau sell his birthright to Jacob for food because he was so hungry. We also see a covenant being made by God with Jacob. And he told him not to go down to Mitzrayim, Egypt, but to stay, and he will bless him and perform the oath that he gave to Abraham and make his seed be as the stars of heaven. And he gives his seed all of those countries. He would give his seed all those countries, and in his seed all the nations of the earth would be blessed. Now Isaac dwelt in Gerar, and the men ask about Rebekah, and because he feared for his life, he said that she was his sister. After a commotion and some things happened, but the king told everyone not to touch Isaac or Rebekah, or they would be put to death. Isaac sold in the land and received 100-fold the same year, and he grew great, and he had possessions and flocks and herds and servants, and the Philistines envied him, and they stopped his wells. And there was a dispute over the wells. And where he dug new wells, they would claim them as theirs. Isaac went to Beersheba, and the Lord appeared to him and said he would bless him. And he was with him for Abraham's sake. And a covenant was made with Abimelech. And afterwards, Isaac's servants found water again. Jacob obtains Isaac's blessings with his mother's encouragement and help by deceit, knowing that Jacob would use his senses and his eyes were weak. Jacob also blesses Esau, but he tells him he will live by the sword and will serve his younger brother. Jacob has to flee for fear of Esau. And suddenly he was to leave for a few days, and he went to the land where Laban lived. And his parents sent him to find a wife of Padan Aram. But Esau took of the women of Ishmael. The Haftarah portion was in Malachi. And we see the prophet writing what the Lord said about Israel, and that he loved Jacob, but he hated Esau, and the Lord would be magnified. And he said, the Lord rebukes the priest in their offerings of polluted bread, the blind and lame sacrifices. He said, cursed be the deceiver, and he who sacrifices the corrupt thing. He rebukes Israel's unfaithfulness and said, if you won't hear to give glory to my name, I will send a curse unto you. He speaks of the covenant he made with Levi, and how law of truth was in his mouth, and iniquity was not found on his lips. And he turned many away from iniquity. He said the priest's lips should keep knowledge and seek the law, for he's the messenger of the Lord. And the Brit Kadoshah portion is in Romans chapter 9. Rav Shaul, Paul, writes how he feels about his brothers in the flesh, the Israelites, to whom pertain the adoption and the glory and covenants, the law and the servants of God and the promises. He said, not as though the word of God has taken none effect, because they are not all Israel, which are of Israel. Neither because they are of Abraham's seeds are they the children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. He speaks of the promise to Sarah and how the elder would serve the younger, and repeats, Jacob I loved, but Esau have I hated. He speaks of purposes God has for raising people up like Pharaoh, and would call a people, his people, who aren't or weren't his people. He contrasts Israel and the Gentiles and how the Gentiles have attained right to righteousness and Israel hasn't, because this is of faith. We see in each portion God's love of Israel, the true Israel, and he hates that of the things of Esau, which is doing their own thing. He promises, his promises are for Israel, his people, because of his word and not of anything, any deed that they have done. Let's keep this in mind so we don't boast of anything but his faithfulness to his word. And that word has much in store for us and anyone else who accepts the Lord as Savior and Lord of their lives. Amen. Shofarim.
Praise you, Father. Father, I just thank you, Lord God, that you knew us before we were even formed in our mother's womb. You knew what we would become, Father, when we were born, even before we were born, Lord. Father, it's you who ordains each one of our lives, Father, what we will become. It's not by works, but it's by your calling, Lord God. And I want to praise you this morning. And thank you. And I ask, Lord God, that you would just help each one of us, Lord God, to walk in the calling that you have given us. And I want to give you praise. Father, I pray today that you would just touch each one of our hearts, Lord God, with your word today. That we would learn from your holy scriptures. That we would eat the manna that you have for us this morning. I thank you that each one of our hearts have been prepared, Father, before we even got here, to receive what you have. Lord, I want to praise you this morning in worship. And I want to thank you and give you honor along with the congregation, Lord. We will lift up holy hands and give you honor and glory because you deserve all honor and glory. You are holy. You are worthy. We magnify you this morning. We look forward to seeing you one day, Lord God, face to face. Father, this morning I pray that you would just let your presence fall. Let your presence fall upon us, Father, that we might worship you this morning with all of our hearts. Thank you, Father, for what you're going to do. Thank you for the anointing upon this service, upon the rabbi. Thank you for all that you have done for us this week. Touch anyone, Lord God, here that needs a touch from you. Father, I lift up every prayer request that has been put on the prayer chains, Father, and I ask, Lord God, that you would move in a mighty way on each request, on each person, Lord God, that needs a touch from you, from heaven. Thank you, Lord, for all you're doing in our lives. In Yeshua's name, amen.
Amen, amen. Let us stand together and begin today's worship. For how lovely the tents of Jacob and the dwelling places of Israel. Ma tovu halecha Yaakov mishkenotze koyizra. Yeah. m'a sauvé. Alecha Yaakov Mishkeno Teka Yisrael Ushaftimayim besesam Mimanea Yeshua Shaftimayim besesam Mimanea Yeshua Mayim, 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 mayim. Oh, my best is some, my, 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 my. Oh, my best is some. Hey, hey. Oh, my, 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 my best is some, my, 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 my best is some. Shaft in my best is some. Me, my name, Yeshua. Shaft in my best is some. Me, my name, Yeshua. My, 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 my. Oh, my best is so, my, 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 oh, my best is some. Hey, hey. Oh, my, 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 best is some, my, 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 best is some. Therefore, with joy, we shall draw water from the wells of Yeshua. Amen, amen. You may be seated.
Oops. We begin the siddur with the Baruch Hu. Baruch Hu et Adonai Hamvorach. Baruch Adonai Hamvorach Leolam Va'ed. Bless the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed is the Lord, the Blessed One, for all eternity. V'shamru v'nei Yisrael. The children of Israel shall keep the Shabbat, observing it throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Shabbat to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord. The blessing of the Mashiach together. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam. Asher natan lanu et derek ha-yeshua b'mashiach yeshua. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the way of salvation in Messiah Yeshua. Amen. Please stand for the Shema.
Shema Yisrael. Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kavod, Malkuto. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kavod, Malkuto Leolam Vayed.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be the name of his glorious kingdom forever and ever. Amen. Ve'ahavtem. Ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha b'chol levavka v'kol nafshecha v'kol moldecha. V'hayu haverim ha'elim, asher nokim etzavka hayom alavavecha, v'shinan tam levenecha, v'dabarta bam, v'ashivta kvevitecha, v'lekta kvevderek, ushak baka v'kumekam, v'ukshar tam yota idecha, v'hayu letavo benenecha, v'uktab tam zot pitecha, v'visharekam. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might,
And these words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall speak of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you rise up. You shall bind them for a sign upon your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Ve'ahavta l'reacha kamocha, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Amen. Ha'amida. Blessed are you, Lord our God, and God of our fathers, God of Abraham, God of Yitzchak, and God of Yaakov, the great, mighty, and awesome God, the Most High God who bestows grace and creates all, and remembers the kindnesses of the fathers, and brings a Redeemer to their children's children for his name's sake with love. O King, Helper, Savior, and Shield, blessed are you, O Lord, Shield of Abraham. You are eternally mighty, my Lord. The resurrector of the dead are you, abundantly able to save, who sustains the living with kindness, resurrects the dead with abundant mercy, supports the fallen, heals the sick, releases the confined, and maintains his faith to those asleep in the dust. Who is like you, O Master of mighty deeds, and who is comparable to you, O King, who causes death and restores life and makes salvation sprout? Amen. Eloheinu ve'elohei avutenu, our God and God of our fathers, may you be pleased with our rest. Sanctify us in your commandments and grant us our portion in your Torah. Satisfy us from your goodness and make us rejoice in your salvation. And purify us to serve you in truth, in love and favor, O Lord our God. Grant us your holy Shabbat as a heritage, and may Israel sanctify your name, rest therein. Baruch atah Adonai Mekadesh HaShabbat. Blessed are you, O Lord, who makes the Shabbat holy. Kaddish, magnified and sanctified be his great name in the world, which he has created according to his will. May he establish his kingdom during your life and during your days and during the life of the whole house of Israel, even swiftly and soon, and all say, let his great name be blessed forever and to all eternity. Blessed, praised, and glorified, exalted, extolled, and honored, magnified and lauded be the name of the Holy One. Blessed is he, though he be high above all blessings and songs, praises and consolations, which are uttered in the world, and all say, Amen. May he who makes peace in his high places make peace upon us and upon all Yisrael, and say, Amen. Yitgadal, Yitgadal Shemet Rabbah. Amen. Amen.
Oh, say shalom bimramav, hu yase shalom aleinu, ve'yacho Yisrael, bimru, amen. Oh, say shalom bimramav, hu yase shalom aleinu, ve'yacho Yisrael, v'imru, imru, amen. Yase shalom, yase shalom, shalom aleinu, Yaakov Yisrael, Yase Shalom, Yase Shalom, Shalom Aleinu, Yaakov Yisrael, Yase Shalom, Yase Shalom, Shalom Aleinu, Yaakov Yisrael, Yase Shalom, Yase Shalom, May he who makes peace in high places make peace for Israel and for all mankind, and say, amen, amen, amen. Father, we come through your gates with thanksgiving, Father. We come to your courts with praise. Lord, we ask that our worship, Father God, would echo around your throne today, Father God, that you be pleased in our worship. That our praise, Father God, changes our minds, our hearts, Lord, to be here, to be excited about standing in front of your presence, Lord. We ask that you just move in this place today, Father God. Accept our offering of praise, Lord, as we worship.
And into your courts we run with praises flowing from my heart. Every day I wake, I sing your song. It's the anthem of my life. I want to spend my days in your presence, Lord. Defy me for you're the wrong. In the house of God isn't where I find, isn't where I find my home is heaven. One day, Lord, I will live in your courts. You find me in worship at your feet. Hide me now in the shadow of your wings, where I will be, where I will be. Oh, yes, and your love is all I need so desperately. I saw your face. I know you hear my every cry and petition that I make. Want to spend my days in your presence, Lord. Bow before your throne. In the house of God is where I find my home is heaven. One day, Lord, I will live your court to find me in worship at your feet. Hide me now in the shadow of your wings, where I will be. Yes. And home is heaven. One day, Lord, I will live in your court to find me in worship at your feet. Hide me now in the shadow of your wings, where I will be, where I will be.
Your love is all I need so desperately. I saw your face. I know you hear my every cry and petition that I make. God is where I find my peace. Home is heaven. One day, Lord, I will live in your court to find me. Worship at your feet. Hide me now in the shadow of your wings. It's where I will be. Where I will be. Worship at your feet. Hide me now in the shadow of your wings, where I will be, where I will be.
Holy fire,
and burn away
my desire for anything that is not of you and is of me. I want more of you and less
you fill me with you.
Yeshua. shakes the earth, shakes the heavens. The hope of every heart, the Savior of the world, Yeshua. And the name is lifted up forever. The name that shakes the earth, shakes the heavens. The hope of every heart, the Savior of the world, Yeshua. Yeshua.
Praise you, God. Father, I think of your word, how it says that every knee, every heart, every person will bow to the name of Yeshua, your great, holy, and awesome name. This morning, Lord, we just put into perspective your name. We put into perspective, Lord, the awesomeness of who you are, that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are above all things. Nothing is above you, Father God. You stand alone. Your name is victorious. Your name brings life and hope and peace only in you, Father God. And so today I pray that as we worship you, as we come into your presence, Lord, that these people that stand before you cry out to him, cry out to your God, call upon the name, call upon his name. He is before you. He has given you access to him. So today, God, we call upon your name. And as we worship and as we praise, Lord, I believe that your power, you will speak forth in power, that you would come down and break any chain that is keeping us down. Anything, despair, depression, anxiety, fear, Lord, hopelessness, whatever. Any lie that Satan has tried to creep into our life, Father, we rebuke and we come in the name of Yeshua. We proclaim you as our God and King. We acknowledge that it is only by your name that we are saved. And Father, we just come and we just thank you that we have access to your name. That's so heavy on my heart this morning. And I thank you that you are moving in this place and that your presence is here. And that as we call upon you, our lives will be made new. In Yeshua's name, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise you, God.
Praising you, heavens and all that's above. Praising you, angels and heavenly hosts. Let the whole earth praise him. Praising the sun, moon, and bright shining stars. Praising you, heavens and waters and skies. Let the whole earth praise him. Praising you, heavens and lords above. Praising you, angels and heavenly hosts. Let the whole earth praise him. Praising the sun, moon, and bright shining stars. Praising you, heavens, you waters, you skies. Let
Before your presence, your throne, forgive us of our sins, wash us and cleanse us. May your presence fill this place, your glory surround us, Shekhinah, clothe us in your glory, Father. We honor you, we praise you, we do lift you high today. On this day we rest to bring you honor. We ask that your word would come forth, that would speak boldly into our lives. Father, you would grab us, Lord, by your wings, take us to where you've called us to be, that you would remove all obstacles, Lord God, that you would order up our steps, establish our paths, that you'd be a light to our feet, that, Lord God, we know you govern over all the earth, all the heavens. You are still and will be forever King of Kings, Yeshua HaMashiach. The congregation says, Amen.
Vahi ben Soah Aaron, when the ark would travel, Moshe would say, Arise, Lord, let your enemies be scattered. Let them that hate you flee from you, for out of the Zion shall go forth the Torah, and the word of the Lord from Yerushalayim. Blessed be he who in his holiness gave the Torah to his people, Yisrael, Ya'amod, Yehuda, Ben Eliyahu, La Torah. Baruch Hu et Adonai Hamvarach, Baruch Adonai Hamvarach, Leolam Va'ed. Baruch Ata Adonai, Eloheinu Melech Olam, Asher Bachar Benu Mikol Ha'amim, V'natan Lanu Et Torato, Baruch Ata Adonai, Notein HaTorah. Bless the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed is the Lord, the Blessed One, for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who chose us from all people and gave us the Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Yeladim.
What? Let's try this a little louder. You gotta wake me up. I'm falling asleep. Okay. Okay, 1 second. Ready? You guys gotta wake me up. All right. Lord, we just thank you for these blessed children and the families that they represent. May they be blessed abundantly as Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah, Ephraim, and Manasseh. Lord, I ask that you place a hedge of protection around about these little ones, that you would keep them from harm's way, and that you would keep them away from the sicknesses that are around about us, oh Lord, during these seasons. Lord, I also ask that as they grow and mature physically, Lord, and spiritually, that you would draw them near to you for those that haven't received you yet as their Messiah. Yeshua, I ask you to draw them to you, and they realize who you are, their Mashiach. And as they grow and mature, that you would use them, Lord, in the calling that you have for them on their lives. In Yeshua's name, amen.
Vayelei todot Yitzchak ben Avraham. Avraham holid et Yitzchak. Vayhi Yitzchak ben Arba'im Shana b'chakto et Rivcha bat Betuel Harami. Mi padan Aram, achot Levan Harami lo leisha. Vayatar Yitzchak ladonai lenochak ishto ki akora hiv. Vayater lo Adonai Vatahar Rivka Ishto.
And these are the generations of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham begot Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Bethuel the Syrian, and Padanaram, the sister to Laban the Syrian. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord was entreated of him, and Rebekah his wife conceived.
Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher natan lanu torat emet v'chayei olam nata betochenu baruch ata Adonai notein haTorah. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the Torah of truth and has planted eternal life within us. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Vazor haTorah she'asa Moshe lifnei b'nei Yisrael al pi Adonai b'yad Moshe. And this is the Torah that Moses placed before the children of Israel at the command of the Lord through Moses' hand. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. This Torah scroll is the Word of God. Yeshua is this Word. John the Immerser said in John 1:29, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. God's word is written on lambskin. Yeshua is this Lamb. In John 12:32, Yeshua said, and I, if I'm lifted from the earth, will draw all people to myself. The two wooden poles holding this Torah scroll are called Eitz Chaim, or Tree of Life. Yeshua was sacrificed on two wooden poles some 2,000 years ago for our sins. Amen. Eitz Chaim hi lamachazikim ba, v'tomchei ha-mushar, drachei dokane am, v'kol netavatecha shalom, shevein Adonai alecha, v'neshuva kadesh, yemenu kekadem. It is a tree of life to those who take hold of it. Happy are those who support it. Its ways are ways of pleasantness, and all its paths are peace. Cause us to return to you, Adonai, and we shall return, renew our days as of old. Revelation 2:7 reads, you as an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the congregations. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Yeshua was, is, and shall ever be this word of the one living God that we look upon this day for our salvation. Amen. You may be seated.
How many ready to study the word this morning? Okay. This week I'm going to be teaching on generations. Next week I'm going to be teaching on relationships. By combining these two teachings, it's too long. I don't want you all falling asleep like the kids were this morning. I'm going to break it up into two teachings, one for this week and one for next. I want to draw your attention to something, though. With all this stuff going on with the pandemic and all that stuff, there's all kinds of things going on. One of the things that we did is, as of yesterday, you may have noticed a sign on two of the doors that talk about air purification. I went ahead and had installed air purifiers, four of them, on every area, and it circulates the air every 30 minutes, and it purifies the air, and it kills everything. It's the same system that's used in the hospitals. To clarify and pure the air. So I had those installed for us. It covers all kinds of things, allergies and all this kind of thing. And supposedly there's a smell that that you'll smell. So if you smell something different, if we didn't have to have our masks on, you'd be breathing fresh air. One day, Lord willing, we'll be able to put this experience and time behind us. But we're taking the precautions that we can take along the way, okay? So let's start the teaching this morning. That's entitled Generations, History, or Toldot. And let us start by asking ourselves a question. For those that may be listening to this didn't hear. But the generations that we're speaking of is in the Hebrew Toldot. This is the parasha for this week. And we have to ask ourselves a question. When you don't study history, it tends to repeat itself. How many know that? Okay. Well, the same is true with the Word of God. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verses 5 through 6, and Genesis 27, verse 38, it says the following.
Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths.
So we have to continue to read his verses and read his instruction for us as we live our lives, and then apply it to the events and circumstances and things that are around about us in order for us to benefit from God's guidance for us, but also to benefit from us not having to repeat the mistakes that have been made in the past. Genesis 27:38 says,
"And Esau said unto his father, Hast thou but one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, O my father." And Esau lifted up his voice and wept.
Today's teaching is to help you so you don't repeat events that could happen to you. You need to learn from the mistakes of the past, specifically in Scripture, to avoid the mistakes of the future. Now let's look at some history of Esau to learn how not to be like him. And this will be the first phase of this discussion. Let me put something in your head as we go through this. How many know that we are flesh and spirit? Right? We have these fleshly bodies. These bodies are corruptible. They will perish, but we will have incorruptible bodies for those that believe in the life to come and the life everlasting. We also have a spirit within us. How many know that? We're flesh and we're spirit. And those two things have a tendency to do what? Clash with each other. Sometimes it's the clash of the titans, where you may be spiritually strong and you may be physically strong, and they clash with one another. Sometimes, and in most cases, one is weaker than the other, and it ebbs and flows throughout your life. And that'll be some of the discussions that we'll go through. And this is a great portion, this Torah portion is a great example in Scripture to focus in on this. To get into the deeper meanings of what Scripture is. And I'm going to give you some other examples on how many study the Bible? How many study the Bible, right? Okay. So I'm going to give you some examples also on some teaching ways to teach you how to study the Bible in a different way also, to get more out of the Scriptures than maybe what you've gotten before from reading the literal word, reading commentaries, reading other things, but to get the essence out of the Word of God, because how many know the Word of God's alive? I mean, you can literally picture the Word of God breathing, opening and closing, getting larger, getting smaller. Sometimes as you read Scriptures, sometimes they don't have an impact on you, but how many as you're reading, sometimes you read Scriptures and all of a sudden something catches your eye? Every time you run across verses in an area in the Scriptures that catches your eye, or something causes it to grow within your eyes, that's when you pause and then you begin to study that area. Okay? All right. So, not repeating the mistakes of the past. Looking now, let's look at Esau. Genesis, Bereshit 25:23 says this.
And the Lord said unto her, Two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. And the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger.
The elder serves the younger. You see, there were twins in there. God's prophetic word is speaking here in these verses. You can take these and relate these as you read the story that we have here today in this Toldot. You'll be able to read it and understand these relationships as it comes to us as creatures created by God in the flesh and in the spirit. Romans 9 verses 10 through 11 says this.
And not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac, for the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to the election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth.
This is exactly what Ribbetzin Yvonne prayed this morning about this specific example. We in our inner being, God chooses, he calls and he chooses, and he chooses. It means that you were chosen, and things that are going to happen to you as you grow and mature, you can choose to go different directions, but God provides you with something where you haven't made those choices. And I'll get more into that next week about these differences between what happens as we get older and how it relates to the will of God. You know, for example, How many know we all have a will? How many know that's what makes God's creation of us different from all the other creations? We have a will, right? Right? If, what would hinder the will? Let's use an animal as an example. I'm chasing a rabbit here, but I need to put this in your head, and I'll share it with you more next week. But when we look at a will, how do you get a dog to listen to you? How many have animals? How many have a dog? Okay. How many have fish? How many have a cat? Well, cat's not a good example because you can't train them anything. We have a cat person in the back. I did that for her benefit. So, herding cats are impossible. It's impossible. Type A personalities, herding them is impossible. So, when we're looking at training an animal, what do? You try to train them. You try to encourage them. You give them something. I don't see Derek here, but Derek trains the guy that was standing up here doing the moment. He trains dogs, and he knows the specifics on what you have to do to train a dog. When you take and train a dog, you will train them by giving them a treat. What happens? They realize that if you give them a treat, they're going to get rewarded. And that reward is for actions that they did before they got the treat. Eventually, it changes their behavior, and they will do it without the treat, right? Some people wonder why God doesn't respond to you, because God doesn't use treats with us. He doesn't use treats with us. You know why he doesn't use treats with us? Because it impacts our will. If God treats us and doesn't allow us to choose the actions we're going to take, then our will is done away with. Are you getting that? You understand that concept? God has us, he will not impact our will. That's the way he created us. Because we have to choose to do good, or we have to choose to do evil. And God's not going to treat us to do one or the other. That's the uniqueness of the way he created us. Esau was a cunning hunter, whereas Jacob was a mild man. He was a studier. So who do you think Isaac chooses? Who do you think Isaac chooses? You think he chose Jacob? How many say he chose Jacob? That's good. No hands are raised. You must have read the Bible, because it's Esau who Isaac chose. Why did he choose him? For what he does, not who he is. Who would you have chosen today? Would you have chosen Esau, or would you have chosen Jacob? Would you have chosen him based upon who he is, a mighty hunter? Or would you choose him as who he was, or who he is in his inner being? People react and pick heroes, and I'm using heroes as an example. They pick heroes out of the way they look, the way they act, the way they are on the outside. That's why actors are so influential. How many listen to actors? Many people listen to actors. Why? Because the people are reacting to what they act to, but that's not them. That's not them. They're acting. That's not what they are on the inside. It's only what they are on the outside. Heroes are the same way. Sometimes heroes are the result of events that happened, and they become heroes. But heroes are not spiritual leaders. Isaac favored Esau, who was spiritually dull. Why was he spiritually dull? Because his example is and was in physical things. He emphasized the physical things, not the spiritual things. He was more into the things that were physical. Isaac looked to the physical side and not the spiritual side of Esau in his selection process. If he would have been influenced by the spiritual side, he would have picked Isaac. Or he would have picked Jacob. as opposed to Esau. Isaac would have picked Jacob instead of Esau. This is the outside in versus the inside out. You got that? Outside in versus the inside out. This was and is a big problem. Outward appearances, big problem. Outward appearances, physical appearances, mental appearances, listening to words spoken by people and you're influenced by what they have to say, that's all outward impact. So how does this happen? The physical is influenced by the senses. Once again, we as human beings have senses. Now, in reference to Genesis Bereshit 27, we see the use of Isaac's five senses, which are in an integral part of Hebrew thought for learning and is good for teaching if used in the right context. This is what I'm talking about, a new level of teaching that it takes time to practice this. It takes time to learn it. It's almost like learning to ride a bicycle. You have to try it first, just stumble. It's a little hard, but then over time you'll get to it and it becomes what they call muscle memory, where it just becomes natural. For those that know how to play instruments, you can play the instruments and read the music and do that where muscle memory takes hold. But looking at this level of study, let me focus in on that for a second if I can. So, as we begin to go into these next verses, I want you to do a couple things. How many know that we have five senses, right? And the sixth sense is something that was developed or has come up by psychologists, and that's something that's not proven. It's something that's identified differently. But we have physically five senses, right? How many know what those senses are? How many know what they are? Okay. Let's look at the first one. Let's look at seeing. How many in here can see? All right. Focus in on something. Focus in on something and picture what you're seeing. Okay. See that? Focusing in on what you can see. All right. Now, the next thing is hearing. How many can hear? Okay. You're hearing my voice. That's hearing, right? You can hear my voice. It's not seeing, but it's hearing. This is what you'll hear about this next week. It's not seeing, but it's hearing. How many know there's a different sense? Totally different, totally unrelated to one another, right? What's the next one? Well, you could order those in different ways. But let's say touching's the next thing, okay? Touch the person next to you. And if you only have somebody next to you, touch the chair. What's that feel like? Damien, you're not touching the chair. What's that feel like? You feel it? That's touch. That's touch. Can you know. Now, what's your brain telling you? Your brain's telling you, I touched the person next to me, or I touched the chair, I did something, but that's a different sense, different from seeing and different from hearing. Now, what's the next one? How many's hungry? Uh-huh. People get hungry, right? Well, you'll be hungrier after this two-hour sermon. Hungry. What's that sense? What is that sense? It's tasting. You get the taste. Your stomach starts growling. How many know that when you don't eat and then you go eat, after your stomach started growling, the taste is more amplified than it is if you just had another meal? How many know that? How many have experienced that? Taste is different. And then finally, the fifth one is smell. Take a deep breath. What do you smell? You know, through your nose, not through your mouth, through your nose. How many can smell something, right? Most of you smell your mask. Pretty nasty, huh? Nasty, right? Guys need to wash those. You need to wash those. You need to wash those at least once a month or once a week or whatever. So, those are the five senses. Now, why did I walk you through that? Because you should read the scriptures with your senses. How do I know that? Because we're going to start reading them right now. The significance of senses tied into scripture. That's the lesson, one of the major lessons that you should glean from this, from these scriptures that we're going to read. Genesis 27 verse 1 says the following.
And it came to pass that when Isaac was old and his eyes were dim, so that he could not see, he called Esau his eldest son and said unto him, My son. And he said unto him, Behold, here am I.
Okay, what's the first sense we just heard? Seeing? And what did they spend a few words explaining? One, he couldn't see him, but he had to call out to his son to bring his son close to him, right? So his seeing was dull. Now let's go to Bereshit 27, verse 22, which says this.
And Jacob went near unto Isaac, his father, and he felt him and said, The voice is Jacob's voice, but the hands are the hands of Esau.
Now, what did you guys hear? I'm going to have Brian read this one more time, and every time you hear a sense, I want you to yell, stop. Okay? I'm teaching you to ride a bicycle here. It's painful, but I'm going to teach you how to do it. You're going to get balance on reading. All right. Read it again slowly. When you hear a sense, all yell out, stop. Okay?
And Jacob went near unto Isaac his father, and he felt him.
Good. There's one. What is that? What is felt? What is that? Touching. Right. Go ahead.
And said, The voice is Jacob's.
Very good. What is that? Hearing. Very good.
But the hands are the hands of Esau.
Which one's that? What is it? Touch. His hands were the hands of Esau. How do you know it was touch? Because his eyes were dull. Right? Touching and hearing. Bereshit 27, 25 says this. Now let's do the same thing again.
And he said, Bring it near to me, and I will eat of my son's venison.
What? I didn't hear it. You guys were questioning the touch. Ready to stop, right? Well, I'm learning which dominant senses you all have. If you guys were really hungry, you would have stopped when you heard venison. Right? Go ahead. What is that one? Taste. Go ahead.
That my soul may bless thee. And he brought it near to him, and he did eat.
You're coaching him. Don't be coaching him. He did eat. All right, go ahead.
And he brought him wine, and he drank.
See? All right, so we have taste here. Taste is an example. I think it's interesting. I'm going to share this quick. Ribbitzine, don't get mad at me when I did this. But this week she says to me, she goes, I have this desire to have beef stew this week. I don't know why, but so she made this unbelievable great beef stew. It wasn't venison, but it was beef. So when the parasha came up, guess what happened? There's a correlation between what's happening. That's mama's Torah versus the Torah of dad. Not a sixth sense. It's just mama's Torah, okay? All right, let's go to Bereshit 27:27, which says this. Help me out here.
And he came near and kissed him.
Very good. What is that? Touch, okay.
And he smelled the smell of his raiment.
That smell, okay.
And blessed him and said, See, the smell of my son.
See, the see part, that was a trick, right? He didn't see because he's dull. Now, what's this? Go ahead. The smell of my son. Go ahead.
Is as the smell of a field which the Lord hath blessed.
Which is a memory of his. He correlated the smell of his son to the field which he would smell as his son would come back. How many remember going outside and coming inside and smelling like outside, right? All these are important memories. These are all important memories to understand. There is a lesson here about our fleshly senses. Isaac used all four of his senses in Genesis Bereshit 27. But Isaac is still fooled. Why? Because he couldn't see. His sense of sight, he couldn't see, and he was fooled. Why is that? What does that tell us? It tells us his dominant sense must have been sight. His dominant sense must have been sight. And how is this a problem? Is it a problem? The answer is yes. For so-called spiritual people that are led by or influenced by the flesh, it's a problem. Spiritual sight is a problem. It's a problem because sight will get you into trouble. Look at Bereshit Genesis 3:6, which says this.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise.
Stop. How many saw senses through there? You got to practice it. Eventually, after you do this enough, you're going to see these words are going to jump off the page. It's like breathing. How many know the Bible's alive? The Bible breathes. It's the breath of God. It breathes. And things will come out. Go ahead.
She took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat.
The lust of the eyes, they ate the fruit in the garden. Great another example of senses and reading the scriptures and understanding and experiencing your senses as you relate to the words that are being spoken, so you can appreciate the significance of the verses. 1 John 2:16 through 17 says this.
For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever.
So the eyes can be deceiving. You have to be aware of that. It can deceive you. It can lead you into other experiences, and it can cause you to be misled through even your senses. If your dominant sense is sight. Now, how many know that all senses together are important? All of them are important. If you take one individually, it may influence you in another way. We see Isaac, who was totally misled because his dominant sense appears to be sight. This is a good reason why you are to be led by the Spirit and led by your spiritual sight. 2 Corinthians 5:7 says this.
For we walk by faith, not by sight.
Faith is important. Because that is something that will help water down things that appear to be something and are not. Things that you may see currently, but ultimately they may turn out to be different. And it's through faith in what God has told us through his scriptures, that we should not be influenced by sight. And Isaac's a prime example of this, that supports this verse in 2 Corinthians 5:7. So the physical sight is dangerous and misleading if it is your dominant sense. And that dominance carries over into your spiritual lives. Going from the physical to the spiritual. Don't allow your physical senses dominate or carry over into your spiritual lives. This is a very important concept. So what sense should be dominant? What sense should be dominant? Which one, when carried into your spiritual life, leads you to real spiritual benefits? Which one? Any ideas? Holler it out. What is it? That's a sense. Hearing. Hearing should be your dominant sense. What happens to a blind person? The other sense that takes over and becomes more keen with exercise. Hearing. Did you see what Isaac said? Isaac, hearing is most important. Why do you think God chose hearing? How many read the Word of God? How many hear the Word of God? How many read it out loud to hear it? Or how many hear it when you read it because you're just not speaking it out, but you hear it in your spirit? There's significance in hearing. It causes you to become more keen as you exercise it in your spiritual walk. If you walk in spiritual sights and not in fleshlight, you're more attuned to what is going on, which comes by hearing the Word of God. The Word of God coming alive, breathing, amplifies your spiritual eyes to see. That's why when you read the Word of God and you come across something and you say, ah, that caught my attention. That's your spiritual eyes catching on something you just read that's been amplified, that you need to research deeper. Research more, study more, chase the scriptures around, because there's a message in the spirit for you as you study that. Proverbs 16 verse 2 says this.
All the ways of man are clean in his own eyes, but the Lord weigheth the spirits.
Now this is a great verse. This is where everyone will reconcile in their own minds and their own eyes the things that they do. But the Lord weighs the spirit. You will come up with all kinds of excuses through what you do or what you see. But God weighs the spirit. He looks at what the spirit is telling him in each and every one of us. Now, let's read Bereshit 27, 32 through 35 and 36 through 38, which says this.
And Isaac his father said unto him, Who art thou? And he said, I am thy son, thy firstborn Esau. And Isaac trembled very exceedingly and said, Who? Where is he that hath taken venison and brought it to me? And I have eaten of all before thou camest, and have blessed him. Yea, and he shall be blessed. And when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with a great and exceeding bitter cry, and said unto his father, Bless me, even me also, O my father. And he said, Thy brother came with subtlety, and hath taken away thy blessing.
Once the example here, the physical example of Isaac being dull of seeing and being misled in his other senses because they didn't become dominant. He maintained that dominance in his seeing senses. It resulted in him giving a blessing that blessed Jacob, which was intended for Esau. Blessings. Once the blessing's in motion, it's irrevocable. It's irrevocable once it's spoken out. But what about us? Genesis 27, 39 through 40 says this.
And Isaac his father answered and said unto him, Behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth and of the dew of heaven from above. And by thy sword shalt thou live and shalt serve thy brother. And it shall come to pass when thou shalt have the dominion, that thou shalt break his yoke from off thy neck.
Now this comes in two parts. The blessing is that just as Esau was physical, he was blessed physically. His physical being was blessed. That's the first part. Esau was spiritually dull. But when Jacob fails, in the spirit. Esau is dominant in the flesh. You see what I'm saying here? It says in this verse that when Jacob fails, then Esau becomes dominant. This is a physical example of who we are as spiritual beings, and we'll talk about this next week, but the spirit and the flesh. When the flesh is strong, the spirit is weak. And when the spirit is strong, the flesh is weak. You see the correlation be here. It says, but when Jacob fails in the spirit, Esau is dominant in the flesh. This concept's important for us, and this is a learning for us from this example. Interaction. It also lays out the explanation of the sin cycle in the book of Judges. How many have read the sin cycle in the book of Judges? The same cycle is going on. Here, God uses this example in Torah as two extremes. Two individual individuals. They were born as twins coming out of the same womb, but they're two extremes, black and white. That's the way we are. Black and white. We are physical and we're spirit. Two extremes. But when we get into the gray areas, when they mix together, when you look for balance between the two, that's the stability of us as believers, coming into balance with the flesh and coming into balance with the spirit. Esau was spiritually dull because he lacked faith in God, and thus, I believe, he had no interest in seeing God. Hebrews 11:6 says this.
But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
He had no interest because his focus was physical gratification and not spiritual fulfillment. See, this is all focused. When you read Esau, you've got to look at the physical. You've got to look at it in the physical context, even as us as humans. Look in the physical context. If physical gratification and not spiritual fulfillment, because it would cause you to jump over onto the spiritual side. This is another important concept. But if Jacob was weak in the spirit, then Esau would dominate in the physical. This leaves the door open to remember when straying away from God in the sin cycle. I believe many believers today, they run the risk of being like Esau. They spend more time in the physical than in the spirit. They are physical believers and not spiritual ones. That when push comes to shove, they would give up their own birthrights as believers for a meal of stew. Except ribbon stew, that's different. Because they think that they are physically hungry when in fact they are really spiritually hungry. 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 3 says this.
Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition.
Esau was loved less. It says in Scripture he was hated by God, but in the Greek, love less, the word hated means you're comparing love and hate. And you're comparing, he was loved less than Jacob. He was loved less. He was, in fact, detested by God. Why was he detested? Because he treated the spiritual things, the promises, the birthright, the blessings, the promises. He treated the spiritual things as common. Hebrews 12, 16 through 17 says this.
Lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For ye know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected. For he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears.
So what is a profane person? He treated his birthright as common. Promises meant nothing to him, only the physical, only the now of what made him feel good. He treated something sacred as common because he lacked spiritual insight. This should be a wake-up call for believers today. Do your physical and emotional needs take priority over your spiritual needs? Have you mixed up your spiritual needs with your physical needs to the point that you will give up the spiritual birthright for some physical gratifications? By treating what is sacred, your relationship with Yeshua, as common or profane, when you do, you can run the risk of being like Esau without a blessing. Matthew 7:21 through 23 says this.
Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity.
So how should you treat your birthright? You treat it as a privilege, and you treat it as a privilege if you know him, if you know Yeshua. Revelation 15, 1 through 3 says this.
And I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, seven angels having the seven last plagues, for in them is filled up the wrath of God. And I saw as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast, and over his image, and over his mark, and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints.
So in closing, don't focus on your physical lives over your spiritual believer lives. Galatians 5, 16 through 18 says this.
This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary, the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law.
How you look at it from outside in. Don't do it that way, but rather concentrate on your spiritual believers' lives from the inside out as God sees you and how he made you. Romans 2, 28 through 29 says this.
For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God.
And always remember Numbers 23, verse 20, which says this.
Behold, I have received commandment to bless, and he hath blessed, and I cannot reverse it.
The blessing from God will be irrevocable, as we say each week, and now you know why we say it. Amen. It is our duty to praise the Master of all, to ascribe greatness to the author of creation. For he's made us like the families of the nations of the land and has not placed us like the families of the earth. He's not made our portion like theirs and our lot like their multitudes. And we bend the knee and bow and acknowledge our thanks before the King over kings, the Holy One, blessed be he. He stretches out heaven and establishes earth's foundation. And the seat of his glory is in the heavens above, and the presence of his power is in the most exalted heights. He is our God, there is none other. True is our King, there is nothing beside him. As it is written in his Torah, and you shall know this day and take to your heart, that the Lord, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth below. There is none other. Amen.
Amen, amen. Let us stand together.
The storm overwhelmed, and I cannot hear.
Majesty, majesty. Forever I am changed by your love, in the presence of your majesty. Here I am, humbled by the love that you give, forgiven so that I can by my glory and fire. But now I found the greatest love of all. It's mine since you laid down your life, the greatest sacrifice. You are my
Father God, that you continue to move in us this week, that you would build us up, that you would open our eyes to see, truly see, as we hear your word this week, Father God, that your guidance and direction would lead us, Lord, go before us, surround us. We bless your name, we thank you and we praise you for all that you're doing, what you have done. Know, God, what you are about to do. B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach, the congregation says.
ABC for announcements. Okay. We will be posting, obviously, this message on YouTube and Facebook, so I encourage you to check it out there. We are still working on making copies of the messages. So if you do want a copy of today's message CD, please see me. I'll write your name down, and we'll get it to you as soon as we can. Also, Kathleen, if you want to come on down.
I just felt that God wanted me to share this. It goes right along with this message today. As some of you know, my dad is in Wisconsin, and his health is not very good. And I found out last Wednesday that his cancer seemed to have spread to other organs of his body. And of course, you go through all these anxiety things, and it's like, I should be there. Well, fortunately, my brother's up there. He went up there Monday and was supposed to leave Friday. I was struggling with the things of sight, the cancer, all this stuff going on with my dad. And the nurse practitioner I work for is pregnant. She's due to deliver any day. And I'm concerned about work. I'm concerned about leaving her, you know, in the lurch, trying, because her last day is the 23rd, which is this coming Monday. So I'm dealing with all this anxiety. And Rick told me, you know, why don't you just book your flight and go on the 24th? And I'm not listening. I'm, you know, and just really struggling with this whole thing. Well, if Brittany goes sooner, then we can drive up there. I can fly up there sooner, blah, blah, blah. I'm thinking all this is going in my head. And I told him, I said, you know, I think God's using you as a voice of reason, but I still didn't listen to him. And it wasn't until this last issue with my dad, I think it was Wednesday, or I don't remember what day of the week was, he ended up being in the hospital. He kind of fell, and my brother decided to stay through the 27th. And I knew that God was using Rick as my voice of reason to use the sense of hearing and not all the situations going on in front of me. And so I just praise God for that. I mean, I know it sounds silly and trite and maybe small, but it's not. I think, you know, God uses all these little things to help us realize he's in the little things. He worked it out. I mean, I know it sounds really weird, but even I talked to a friend that I work with who's a Christian, and he says, well, you got birth and you got death. He goes, it all kind of goes together. And it couldn't have happened at a better time, because I won't have to worry about work. My nurse practitioner is going to be gone. She's going to be gone for 3.5 months. So my job is secure. I don't have that issue. So I just praise God, and I thank you for that. And I just felt that I needed to share that with all of you.
That's awesome. Praise God. I'm not sure if many of you saw it, and I'll be sending an email out today after Shabbat at some point, but our senior rabbi, he put together an updated Rosh Pinah, Talpiot, and Yeladim proficiency outline for all of for all of our kids and the different level of classes that they're in. So what he did was he went through and detailed at each level what they're going to be covering and focusing on, whether it's the content, like the scripture that they're going to be reading, which they're going to be going through the Parsha cycle. So as parents, we read with our kids, you know, they'll be reading the whole Torah each year, which I think is awesome. You know, there's definitely different Hebrew terms and different our faith concepts that are in there. So I would just encourage you, I just wanted to call it out in case some of you did not see it, because definitely as parents, I mean, obviously Rosh Pinah has phenomenal teachers. We all know that. But of course, they only get, 40 to 50 minutes one time a week. So clearly, if the kids are only getting that stuff back in the rooms and not during the week, then they're not going to retain it. They're not going to grow, right? It's up to us as parents to take what they're learning and also build on that at home. So I wanted to call that out just in case you did not see it. It's on the website. I'm going to be sending under the From the Rabbi, right? Under From the Rabbi section. So I'm going to be sending an email out just to give you a link to that so it's easier to get to. But I just wanted to call out to make sure you know that it is out there. And this is what the kids are going to be going through going forward. All right. Other than that, Zadaka Box and Backs tithes offering donation. Also remember that Rosh Pinah accepts PayPal if you'd rather get away from checks, as we're in the modern world today, and you'd want to be more technically savvy. But yes, checks, cash, whatever it might be, put in an envelope, place your name and what it's for. And then also we have PayPal. And then over here, we have the praise reports and prayer requests. And Paul just raised his hand. Safety team meeting tomorrow, 11 o'clock here at Rosh Pinah. All right, Michael. It's savvy, okay? It's savvy. You weren't supposed to catch that. Anyways, on that note, Shavuot Tov.